Okay, thanks for the introductions. That sounds great, and we're basically on time, so I think we can jump right into what we're going to talk about today. So obviously we're going to start out talking about just a general introduction to metagenomics, and we'll talk a little bit about some other omics. I'm going to focus a bit on taxonomy and how you can assign taxonomy to figure out the composition using metagenomics. Later today, Robin's going to tell you all about MAGs, metagenomically assembled genomes. Tomorrow morning will be functional, which is going to be a pretty big topic, obviously, because it includes lots of different things. And then the last one will be a bit on more statistics and what we were calling sort of advanced statistics, which is really scary for us. But the idea about using more complex models. Like linear mixed models to include things like confounding variables in your data, as well as a little bit of machine learning that we're going to try to squeeze in at the end in half an hour. So that should be entertaining as well. And then the last thing I want to mention is obviously for the new people coming is obviously this is your workshop. Please ask questions while I'm talking at any time. Ask the TAs in between at coffee breaks. The reason for coming here in person is really that interaction, right? I mean, you could just probably get the slides and the content afterwards, but there's something about, I think, interacting with each other and asking questions. And because it sort of is an advanced workshop, you know, don't feel like there's going to be basically, it's hard to cover all the possible things we can do with metagenomics. So that looks like it's not going to be covered. Ask away, and maybe I can, you know, spend a little bit of time talking about something in that area at least for you. Okay, great. Well, then let's get started. Wonderful. So the learning objectives for this lecture will just be some general approaches for characterizing the microbiome, talking about if you have host-associated sequence data, how we should handle that, how it should be removed, go over some of the general challenges with metagenomic data taxonomic annotation, why it's difficult. And then understand some of the major approaches for taxonomic assignment within MGS data. And we'll go over in a bit more detail sort of two popular methods, I would call them Kraken and Metaflan, in a bit more detail. Okay, so just to bring it back a little bit, in the beginner workshop, we talked all about 16S, so I'm not going to discuss that here. We're just going to sort of jump right into other approaches. But obviously, compared to an amplicon-based approach where you're amplifying up a single gene, metagenomics, restating this again, is just sequencing all the DNA in a sample. I think it's something to keep in the back of your mind when you could possibly be finding weird things, or when you're filtering or just accounting for things, what other possible DNA could be in my sample besides, you know, microbes. And so that's a good thing to think about. Like recently, we started thinking about this with low biomass samples and tumors or guts, right? Like what other DNA would be in there? Oh, you're thinking it's going to be human, it's going to be bacteria. Oh, there'd probably be maybe some bacteria or some DNA, sorry, from, you know, the plants we eat, right? And who knows what else in there. So I think it's something good to keep in the back of your mind. And then the other beautiful thing about metagenomics is instead of just having to focus on one sort of type of microbe, we can essentially profile lots of different types of microbes. So you still be maybe interested in primarily bacteria, but now you can expand out directly to being like at the same time, hey, what fungi are in here? If you're interested in viruses, I can look at viruses as well. And I can look at other microbial eukaryotes. So it opens up that possibility of not just focusing on, say, bacteria. And then the other big thing is, of course, is that now we can get into, you know, not just describing what species are there in the sample, but also getting into what functions maybe those things are doing. So looking at gene abundances and pathways, and getting a clue of at the community level what's happening functionally, and you can compare obviously communities with different functions. Obviously, the next sort of level up from that, I think what we think about is metatranscriptomics. And obviously, that's just sequencing all the RNA in the sample. And obviously, the big difference there is now we get, you know, a bit more linked to actual function. We get to describe things that actually is transcribed. So that helps a little bit in that, you know, there could be activity. If it's RNA that you detect, it's likely that it came from an alive cell, right? Whereas metagenomics could be from degraded cells or as dead cells and just DNA that's passed through. And obviously you can ask questions about, you know, much more temporally, what's changed over time functionally. And so the scale at which you can see changes obviously is happening much quicker than changes at the DNA level. Metatranscriptomics comes with its own problem set, obviously. I mean, DNA essentially is very hardy, right? I mean, people actually ship us DNA to the to our sequencing center, just sometimes not on ice or anything. They just ship it across international borders, and then it just goes in an envelope, essentially. But RNA is obviously very, has much more rapid turnover, even within the cell, and it obviously is very unstable, you know, from an isolation standpoint. So I think that's something to keep in mind if you are going to do metatranscriptomics, really sort of thinking about what the question is and are you getting the time points you sort of need. We're not going to talk a lot about metatranscriptomics in the advanced section here, but a lot of the same things that we're going to go over for metagenomics can be applied to metatranscriptomics. Nearly almost all the steps, with maybe just a few pre-filtering steps for removing ribosomal RNA sequences, it would be specific to metatranscriptomics. But really the same approaches can be applied. And so the interpretation is a little bit different, of course. And then of course there is non-sequencing approaches, right? Metaproteomics, we don't have a sequencer quite yet for it, although there's been, you know, a couple of papers showing that maybe nanopore can do it at some level. But identifying, you know, all of the proteins in a sample, if possible, metabolomics is, I would say, even more popular, I think, than metaproteomics. Metabolomics, of course, is like, you can't say metabolomics because that just sounds weird. So people just refer to it as metabolomics. And I would say at this time, you know, metabolomics is really hot, and usually it's paired with some sort of sequencing technology. Could be 16S, but often you'll see it done with metagenomics. And then you're trying to basically piece that data together to make a better cohesive story, right? I mean, you can study the microbiome via just metabolomics if that's what you're into, but I think if the story is much richer, knowing what species are there combined, obviously, with the metabolites as well. Again, we're probably not going to go into too much detail with that, but I'm happy to talk about it. Monica's been, I'll point at Monica. So Monica's been dealing with some data where she has metabolomics, metagenomics, and 16S data, and the fun headaches that comes along with that. Okay, that's great. But I would say for the most of the next 2 days, we're gonna focus on metagenomics, but happy to sort of talk about the other omics as needed. So what's kind of cool about metagenomics is that there's lots of sort of different things we can do, right? So with sort of 16S data, amplicon data, you're really kind of restricted to just describing the different species there and then interpreting it with different microbial ecology metrics. But with metagenomics, you can actually fundamentally do quite distinct things, right? So we can do taxonomic composition, which we're going to talk about today, by assigning reads to some sort of database to get a table of taxa by samples, similar to what we would do with amplicon data. But of course, as I was just saying, we can also do this against functional databases, some which are just comprehensive, but we'll talk tomorrow morning about like very like detailed functional databases that are the question you're answering, right? So if you're really interested in like antibiotic resistance genes, or you're really interested in some sort of carbohydrate metabolism, there's different functional databases for that. The other big one is down here is obviously, as I already referred to, as MAGs, or metagenomic assembled genomes, and our ability to maybe put back together the complex puzzle, which is also very exciting. But then there's some other things as well, like things like this, which is sort of more a bit more simpler, just thinking about read recruitment and how we can take reference genomes, mapping reads to it, and looking for variation in our community versus the genome. And this isn't comprehensive at all, even from a very large standpoint, right? There's all like, there's these neat tools that come out all the time. One that I don't think I'm going to talk about, but this tool I always try to write in my grants, where essentially someone came up with a method that looked at the mapping of reads to genomes to get an idea of how much DNA replication is going on by looking for biases around the origin of replication. I think it's called IREP, although I just drew a little bit of a blank on that. I'll look at it after in case you're interested. But essentially, there's a lot of cool stuff you can do with metagenomics, and it really comes down, obviously, the question you're asking and then like what approach you want to take to it. Okay, so let's we're going to zoom in on taxonomic profiling for now, though, and we're going to basically say, you know, given this complex data with DNA reads from all different types of species in my sample, how do I get a profile of what's in my sample? The sort of most basic question. So there are challenges, of course. So the reads are randomly assorted, right? We don't know what organism it came from unless you've done some sort of more gourmet sequencing where you can actually link the DNA sometimes to know that they were in the same cell. But assuming that wasn't happening, we don't know. The reads are generally short, usually. I'm going to have to change this really soon because obviously more and more people are doing long read sequencing, and we'll talk about that in this lecture. But typically the reads are short, meaning that, you know, we have a limited amount of information in each read. And primarily we're never saturating our sequencing here, right? So on a typical experiment, I don't think I have a slide for this. So for a typical metagenomic experiment, you could be doing anywhere from say 5 million reads per sample all the way up to like 100 million reads per sample or more. I would say most people are doing around 10 to 15 to 20 million. 100 million is really not that abnormal either. It depends on what you're doing. But almost in most of those cases, you're not going to sample, you know, all of the DNA in your microbiome sample. And that means that depending on the how rare or dominant the taxa are that you're looking at, you're going to be selecting, you know, reads from those genomes. So for some genomes, you're going to have pretty good coverage. And for other genomes, it's not going to be very good. And then like what we'll see a little bit later with approaches here, now we have to worry about other types of reads and what's within that read, right? So all of a sudden before, like where we had a target where say it was a 16S gene or the ITS gene, those targets were targeted because they're good for describing taxonomy, right? They're conserved, they're universal. We understand that they sort of evolve over time at a certain rate. Now, if you're getting reads from a genome, we know that, you know, lateral gene transfer or horizontal gene transfer occurs at a significant rate. And you can imagine that sampling a read that basically falls within a recently horizontally transferred gene is going to cause problems for taxonomic assignment. It's going to give you the wrong signal, right? And so that just means that, you know, all our reads aren't really going to be accurate, essentially. And then the other one, which is, you know, you think it's always a big deal, but really with metagenomics, it is computational time. A lot of times we could be like, well, why don't we just do it this way? This seems like the better approach. And it's like, yeah, that's great. But doing it that way for 100 samples is going to take you like months and months, right? And so sometimes and quite often we have to give up a little bit of precision or a lot of precision to make something computational in a reasonable amount of time. On top of that as well, it's just much more demanding on our resources, right? So unlike 16S data, which you could probably do on your laptop if it was beefy or on a fairly small Amazon instance, metagenomics is going to be much more intensive, right? So even though you're going to be using the same Amazon instances, the reality is we have to greatly downsample like our metagenomes to something that will sort of run in a reasonable time, or we make shortcuts. And so that means now you're going to have to really seek out some sort of high performance computing, right? You're going to buy your own server, or you're going to seek out CompuCanada and look for high memory machines. But essentially it's the trifecta of computational times high, high memory requirements, and high storage requirements, which is just like those things are expensive when they're all together. Okay, so that's the challenges. What are the major initial bioinformatic processing steps? So if you are used to 16S data or even other types of sequencing data, we talked about quality filtering. I'm not going to go back over that, but obviously we understand that reads have different levels of quality and we need to filter those to remove reads that we think are low quality and get more high quality reads. We don't want to start with things that are too much junk. And that decision varies a lot. And I'm not going to talk about it here any further, but there's a lot of different tools out there. And there is always a trade-off between obviously losing too many reads and being too stringent versus letting through reads that you think may not be high quality enough. Demultiplexing and lane merging is pretty similar across the board. Demultiplexing is often done by the sequencer. If you're using Illumina, usually with metagenomics, you're using a NextSeq or a HiSeq, NovaSeq. Those have different lanes, essentially, allowing you to multiplex whole groups of samples essentially into a lane. And that just means that very technically, sometimes they come off the sequencer in separate lanes, but it's literally just as simple as concatenating those together, combining the files into one. Quality filtering, right? I already said that. Stitching paired end reads. So obviously this is a specific to Illumina where we have a forward read and a reverse read. Or read one, read two. And we know that those two reads come from the same piece of DNA. And we talked about with 16S data before that you could essentially use that paired end information to make them overlap because you know the fragment size. With metagenomics data, it depends how you process the DNA. You could have a very small fragment, very large fragments, and it's essentially a mixture of fragment sizes. And that means sometimes the forward and reverse read are going to overlap, and other times, quite a few times, they're not going to overlap. Essentially, the fragment of DNA that you've sequenced is this big, and your reads only go here, and they essentially don't overlap, right? So we don't really see, I would say, stitching or joining of paired end reads with metagenomic data as much. We usually use, if you're doing Illumina, you would take the forward reads, you'd use, and the reverse reads, and some tools will use that information. Bowtie, anything that uses Bowtie, we'll see Metaflan later. They're like what we would call forward and reverse read aware, I guess, or paired read aware. So it knows the data is paired and then you would input it. Other tools don't. And essentially what you're left doing is just often combining the forward and reverse reads together into just one big file and then slamming it through that way. So that's a big description about one little bullet point, but does that all make sense? Yeah. Any questions about that? Yeah. Okay, great. One really major different step, I guess, in the genomics, and I sort of alluded to this already, is that we do have to think about removal of unwanted host-associated reads. So we're going to see that if we take reads and try to assign taxonomy to it with whatever methods, we want to think, are we giving it at least reads that are microbial nature, right? Or something that they can classify. Because if you just give any types of reads to some sort of assignment, taxonomy assignment, it could really get lost, right? So if you have human DNA and then you're assigning it only to like some sort of bacterial database, what's going to happen there? Best case scenario, it doesn't get assigned at all, but maybe it gets misled. And so removing that signal can really help make sure hopefully whatever taxonomy assignments you get are accurate. So I talked about human, I'm a bit human centric here, but obviously it could be plant associated, it could be any other animal associated, it could be crustacean associated. If it's something more rare and you don't have the genome of that organism, well, that kind of bites a little bit, doesn't it? Maybe there's a close enough species that you can sort of use as a placeholder for it. But hopefully you do have the host genome and you can remove those. So to do that, it's fairly quite simple. Essentially, you would use a tool called like a mapping tool. So we'll talk about BWA and Bowtie2 a couple of times or other mappers. So these mappers essentially come primarily, I would say, from human genome originally is what they're meant for. And they're great because they're super fast. Okay, so these tools are super fast at taking short reads and aligning them to a genome because they were designed really to map reads to an assembled genome like a human genome. And so we can also use that speed and assigning essentially now our short metagenomic reads to large reference databases. The downside of them is that they're not very sensitive, right? So essentially, if your reads are too distant from the genome, if the percent identity is too low, then they really don't pick up any of that similarity. So essentially, you know, over 95%, you got a pretty good feeling. Over 97%, pretty good. 93, you start to get maybe a bit lower. Less than 90%, you're really going to essentially miss identifying reads. Anyway, so you would take your host-associated genome, whatever it is. If it's the human genome, great, you just download it. If it's something a bit more obscure, you could find that. Maybe, even in the future, you can imagine doing both the host and the microbiome specifically if you think there's variation down the road, like specifically maybe tumor microbe, like tumor genomes, or a strain of a particular or particular types of species that's different. But anyway, that's getting a bit beyond it. Find the genome, create a bow tie database, which is fairly straightforward. And then the other thing you may want to consider adding into that database at the same time is we recommend PhyX, which is used as a spike in with Illumina sequencing technology. Usually those reads are mapped out during from the sequencer, but it's a good idea to put them in your database. And that would go with this host removal process. Yep, question? Yeah. I was thinking about that as I said it. I don't know if I've really thought about this that much because I haven't had to address it. I don't think I have a great answer. Other than I guess I would look at, if there's another genome that's maybe even somewhat similar, you could at least pull out some of the reads. The other reason to do this a little bit is for speed, right? So if it's depending on how much host contamination you have, I call it contamination, but if you can remove, if half of the reads are thought to be host associated, 50%, this will get it out of your way quicker so that you can focus on the reads you care about. Sometimes, the amount of host DNA can be much larger. It could be 80, 90%. And so maybe you want to remove them from this process. But back to your question, I don't really know. Find the most similar species you can and use that. Otherwise, there's some tricky things I could think about, like with composition, but I don't have a great answer there. You basically have to cross your fingers, put it through the taxonomic assignment, and hope that some stuff didn't go too wonky, I guess. But that's Okay, I thought about more. You could probably do assembly, right? So you could do some assembly, even though we're going to focus on read-based approaches right now, and we'll talk about that. You could do some assembly, and then hopefully that would help maybe separate host genome versus microbial reads, assuming the host genome is small. What's your host genome? Right. Oh, well, yeah, no. Plants suck. They have really big genomes, right? Yeah. Right. Yeah, so I haven't actually looked into that issue that much. I'll do a little search, maybe get back to you. Cool. Okay, great. Okay, so we've removed our reads. We're ready to, assign taxonomy. I'm like, let's go get going here. So under the reference-based approaches, which is different from de novo assembly and MAGs, this is sort of a separate approach altogether. Is we're going to take our reads and we're going to try to, from those reads, determine the taxonomic composition, right? So I group these approaches into sort of two major approaches. One is what I call the all reads approach, where you essentially take all the reads and you attempt to assign taxonomy to every single one of those reads. And doing that lets you count how many of that taxa are in the sample, essentially. The all reads approach usually involves some sort of similarity search or what we'll see as k-mers, but sort of similarity. It's computationally demanding, right? You have a large database and now you're doing all your metagenomic reads, which is going to be a significant number. So it's usually computationally demanding. And again, because we're trying to assign taxonomy to every single read, there could be difficulties in doing that. So we talked about LGT already. We know there's just going to be regions of DNA that are quite repetitive, low information content, essentially, that we're not going to be able to assign taxonomy to. So that's not a big surprise. There's going to be a lot of genes and reads that we've just never sequenced before. You still sequence any genome today, and you still get genes that have never been seen before. And so now you can imagine taking multiple genomes within a metagenome community, a microbiome community, you're going to find genes that have never been seen before. So you're not going to be able to annotate all of them anyway. So even though you're attempting to do it for all of them, the reality is you're not going to be able to assign taxonomy to all the reads. If you're talking about soil and things like that, it could be as low as like 20, 25%. In humans, you might get up to 50 or 75. A lot of the things we do is with mock communities. Sure, you're going to get up to close to 100%, but that's not a real community. Yeah. You have a
How do you
question?
deal with like highly conserved homologs?
Yeah, so no, not too much. And we'll see with the next bullet about marker genes. They can be useful. Even with a conserved marker gene, conserved means that, okay, as long as you have, 1% difference in that, and that results in a difference in taxonomy, then it's great.
What if they're like basically the same?
Well, yeah, but you're not going to have conserved genes that are 100% the same across, like, you might have it across species within genus for sure. Yeah. And then we'll sort of see that comes in a little bit of to play when we talk about this lowest common ancestor approach. What happens when you have hits to the same thing at the same level across species? It's the same problem. And essentially what happens is the prediction gets pushed up to its to the branch of that taxonomy that covers it. And then hopefully you can use multiple markers to improve it.
It'll just call like the closest taxa that it can, whether that's genus or
Yeah.
species. Okay.
You're jumping ahead just like before. I'm just joking. It's all good. This way you get to hear multiple times. Yeah, question. Yeah. Oh, you're gonna go just wait, we're gonna get there. I swear we're gonna talk about long reads too. So yeah, right now I guess I am mostly referring to short reads. Yes, because repetitive sequence would be improved by long reads, right? The chance of no homologs for the whole span of a long read is less. LGT, yeah, you can have still large insertions for sure, but you're hoping that maybe you get something else, but maybe that's a whole other. Yeah.
How many times that shows up.
Yeah.
That's
No, it is still relative abundance. Yep. Yeah, it's still sequence based. The same things apply across the board that we have talked about in the beginner. Yeah, so still relative abundance. It does not refer back to the real number of absolute species in a sample.
Yeah, so for example, if my model organism is like a mouse, and like the majority of my reads would be mouse DNA, but also for example, if we have like fungal DNA, viral DNA in our sample, are we going to just take our data set and compare those to the fungal and viral like genome databases want to get rid of those reads?
I guess when I was thinking about host contamination, I was thinking about non-microbial things. So I was thinking more about like the mouse. And then you can get into basically either the tool you use may cover different kingdoms, essentially, if you want to call them that, or they may not. And then you have to do a slightly different analysis for the different things you want to analyze. So say if you were interested in viruses, the tools that we'll see today by default don't really include many virus genomes or at all. So then you have to do basically a whole other analysis just on the viral community. Fungal would be covered some, but maybe it's not quite to, it depends on your reference database, whether it's up to snuff as much as possible. But I would say the general approaches that we're going to talk about here can be applied to multi tools, especially for the all reads approach. So the other sort of approach to use is essentially to use a marker-based approach. So you're instead of like looking at all the reads and doing some sort of search, you're picking out reads that map to good marker genes that we think would be useful for saying if a taxa is present or not, right? That can mean that you're using a very small subset of the total amount of sequencing, right? Because you're just pulling out one or more markers. And obviously then your results are going to depend a lot on what markers you choose. So just to go into detail a bit more about that, this could be as simple as using a single gene, right? You could literally, if you wanted, you could pull out 16S genes from your metagenomics, run a chime analysis on it, and get taxonomy composition that way. You could use other, you know, single genes like CPN60 or other sort of universal genes. People have done that in the past. I would say most people don't want to do that anymore because one, it's just kind of restrictive. You've done all this sequencing and then you're just going to restrict yourself back to a single gene. Like, it's not very satisfying, right? I mean, it probably gets the job done, but why wouldn't you just do the cheaper sequencing? Sometimes people do it as a more of a bioinformatic comparison, like what would the 16S have told me versus all this other data sometimes, and you've since done that. But from like a research standpoint, I don't think most people would do this. And I think most people would be like, yeah, that's okay, but it doesn't seem very sophisticated. But I'm just putting it there as a, you know, a mental thought that you could do that. The other approach is to use several genes. And so that comes down to sort of two subcategories within that. One is using several universal genes. So this is like the 16S, but you take a whole bunch of other genes that we know tend to be universal in that they're present in most of the organisms that you're looking for. And often maybe, hopefully they're in sort of single copy. There used to be a tool a long time ago called Amphora, just Amphora 2. But the biggest one nowadays would be MOTUs. And they're on to their third version of that tool, published in 2022. And they use 10 universal single copy genes to basically profile that. So you take your reads, you map them to these 10 genes, they collapse them essentially into what they would call sort of OTUs, clusters, and then they use that to assign taxonomy. The nice thing about this, just give me 1 second, is that they avoid the issues of LGT, right? They avoid the issues of repetitive DNA or low information content. The beautiful thing about that is you're getting sort of reliable markers. Again, though, because it's only 10 genes, what happens if you've not sampled, you know, if your read doesn't map over one of those 10 universal genes, you're not going to detect it. So your level of detection rate is way less, right? You just can't pick up as many types of taxa. But likely, if you find it, it's there. So high precision. Yeah, sorry, question.
You get to pick the 10
genes? No.
Specific to bacteria?
Oh, good point. Definitely bacteria, and I'm trying to remember if it spans. Yeah, it's a good point. I don't think I have a slide anymore. Maybe bacteria and archaea, but definitely, obviously, there's no universal genes for viruses, and they definitely don't span into eukaryotes, so it doesn't span into fungi or, you know, other proteins. Yeah.
Can you merge like the all regions?
Yeah, you can. In theory, you can. People don't do it, though. They usually use one or the other. They don't often merge those two approaches. People sort of will merge, or I think the better concept is, if you think about mags later on, we'll talk about assembly, a better merge would be between all reads and mags. But I don't think many people would do all reads versus a marker gene, because the reality is you're going to get two different tables. And by merging, I mean, I guess you could take the union or or the intersection, and I don't know which one would be more correct. Oh, I see what you mean. Yeah. I guess I haven't seen that approach very much. Again, okay, so like this is classic. You could do that. But I guess I haven't seen it that much. I guess your idea is use something that's obviously high precision, identify these, then take the rest of your reads and see if you get some other tags that could be there. Yeah, you could do that. I just don't see it done very much. Because the reality is that people like to run a tool, get a table, and then move on with their life and not do two or more things and then try to figure out in their head. It's a great idea, though. I mean, there's lots of areas to do bioinformatic development in this area too, if you like, even though we've been doing it for years. Yeah.
If you're gonna do all the reads, it would get 60x reads, but maybe it's like way more. We need a lot more computational power, so we don't just do the all reads one.
Yes. So the all reads is more computationally expensive, so that's one thing. And I think it comes down to a bit of a different thought about what you're going after. We haven't talked about Metaflan yet next, but in theory, they're going to combine the strength of markers plus sensitivity to do both really well. I think it's not as clear cut as it could be. There's a bit of a trade-off going on there besides computationally. Later on in function, we're going to talk about, what happens when I want to link my taxonomy to functions. And so that's harder with a marker gene approach, where having a direct read map to a taxa and a function provides that information a lot better. Sorry, did I answer your question? Sort of, yeah. Yeah, so essentially, in theory, the all-reads approach sort of does cover the marker gene approach, but underneath the hood, the all-reads approach has to do many more approximations, essentially. And so it's not as sensitive in that similarity searching as well. Yeah.
So the marker-based approaches, I guess they're multiple more specific.
Yep.
What sort of taxonomic resolution?
Oh, very good. Yeah, pretty high actually. I mean, they I just looked at the paper yesterday. It's hard to tell. I haven't used the tool myself. So I mean they say they can get down to species and strains. The percentage of the time that they do that, I can't really comment on. Yeah. Again, they are conserved. So yeah, you can imagine you lose a bit of that sensitivity down to a strain level because it is conserved. But yeah. Okay, so then the other sort of marker gene approach that's multi-gene is a Metaflan approach, I guess. I don't think there's too many others else in this area, but the idea is that they identify what they call clade specific markers. So instead of looking for a gene that's conserved across everything, they actually look for genes that are quite unique to a part of a phylogenetic tree. And, oh, okay, so this unique gene that we've only found in these species ever, that's a good marker for this strain or this species, right? So it's literally the polar opposite of a universal gene. So Metaflan has been obviously through multiple iterations. It is very popular. And the downside has always been, I would say, it's been a bit restrictive on the database size and these markers, which are pre-computed. Metaflan 4 did come out recently. And so they've just, like everyone else, having a bigger reference genome is really important. This goes across the board for everything, as we'll see. And so they sort of came out with their million bacterial and archaea genomes, which is kind of a big splash, I guess, if you can write that in a paper. And the biggest thing was that they combine essentially sort of regular reference genomes from isolations and single cell sequencing. But we know now that MAGs, which we'll talk about later today, have taken off. Basically now people have started to leverage those MAGs to improve our reference genome set. There's lots of caveats in there. It's kind of scary for sure. But if you look at this, 25% is only from the sort of traditional isolation, 75% is from metagenomically assembled genomes. And then what they do is they sort of collapse those genomes into what they call these SGBs or species level genome bins. So they everything at 5% identity across that genome. They just say, okay, we'll take these genomes up, we'll collapse them so we don't have to work with all a million. And then they And of those SGBs, most are known, like they can assign a taxonomy label to it, right to the strain level, but they have significant number of MAGs that, hey, we don't have a name for this, but we're still gonna put it in our database. So if you find something similar, we'll worry about taxonomy afterwards. And then from that, they then look, essentially they pre-compute all these markers. So again, they look for markers that are unique to a specific branch and for each of those, it's not just one marker, they'll use multiple markers. So sometimes it could be as little as 10 for a SGB, or it could be up to 200 markers. And then they look for those markers in your data set. They have an algorithm within it to say, okay, we need so many markers to actually say it's there or not, right? They're not going to just take a single marker to say it's there. It's like a fraction-based thing, which we're not going to get into. But essentially now, the nice thing about this is that they have, instead of like those 10 universal genes you're looking for, you know, in theory, you're scanning a large database of markers and using more of your data. Because they have all these markers and because they're looking for basically really high similarity matches, they can use Bowtie, which I restated is very fast, right? So even though there's a lot of markers, Bowtie is very quick. And essentially, you know, Manifold is not very computational demanding. But the catch is that it's limited to their database. And as we'll see here, Metaflan 4, you can't just be like, oh, I'll just make my own sort of database with the genomes I care about. There's a lot of work that goes behind the scenes to make their markers. And so you're really not stuck, but you're limited to using their database, which at this point is bacteria and archaea. Interesting side note, they used to say that you could also do viruses in, I think, version 3. It never worked very well. And so they've actually dropped that, right? So you see these challenges of like, oh yeah, we can do that. And it's like, no, we can't. So yeah, it's limited to bacteria and archaea. Yeah.
What if you grab a new strain of mind for bacteria, for instance, human genes, so for instance, the ecobacteria has a new diet and so do you have a specific threshold that you can actually say that can be considered as a new bacteria and that's not being identified even though it's belong to the same family? In other words, in a taxonomy tree, where you assign that you get a new bacteria in the genus level, family level, kingdom level?
So with Metaflan, they tend to err towards, they can push it up a little bit, the tree, to say this thing's novel and we don't really know, because they essentially have markers, not just at the tips of the tree, but markers that cover a clade. So essentially what you can do is you can go up and say, well, I see markers to things that are found in this collection of genomes, but I don't see any of the other markers. So you can sort of push it up to that level. That being said, Metaflan focuses a bit more on precision at doing a really good job of saying, this thing is here, I know it's here, I've seen the markers for it. As we'll see in a few slides, things that we've never seen before, or if we're sampling environments that are very diverse, right, where we don't have good genome representation, it can fall over a bit and essentially not detect those tags at all. And essentially, the all-reads approach excels in that area. Okay. Yeah, and I thought I was going to have enough slides. We're only in 15. I've been on time for the past few days. This could be the first one. We'll see. I love the question, though. This is really good. Okay, so now we're going to move on to all read approaches. Within this, essentially, there's quite a few different tools. So Kraken, I'm going to talk about in more detail, combined with Bracken. But there's a lot. Centrifuge was a name thrown around for quite a while. Kju was one. Sour Mash is yet another. And there's others out there for sure. But I'm grouping them all together here. The commonality across, I would say, most of these all-read approaches is because it's computationally demanding, they're not often doing like a bow tie approach or some sort of other similarity search. They're using some sort of approximation. And what they're doing is often what we would call a k-mer-based searching solution. So this is a really fun computer science thing. That's why there's so many different tools developed, because like people are like, I can make this better and faster, right? All the time. And that's why there's all these different approaches essentially within this. And then they combine this k-mer approach with this idea of assigning taxonomy through a lowest common ancestor approach. So let's just tackle that k-mer thing really quickly. So the idea is that you take your database of genomes, you look at obviously all the nucleotides, and computationally ahead of time, you break that genome into k-mers, right? In this example, this is a 5-mer You could use 11 MERS or 13 MERS or 18 MERS, whatever your choice is. And actually, with some of these tools, you can change that option, or they've basically optimized that parameter. But doing this essentially lets you then store these k-MERS in a database, which is computationally really fast then to search your sequence against. So this idea of like mismatches that you would see with something like BLAST or nucleotide differences, that's computationally expensive time. Finding an identical sequence essentially is like instantaneously done in computational time, right? To say, I have this fragment, I need an exact fragment over here. Yes, they match, is like super fast in computer science. And there's ways to store this information so it doesn't get ridiculously huge with suffix trees and things. But the take home message here is that you're not aligning your whole read against the referenced database. They're finding some length of k-mer, mapping it to your reference database and using that as a starting point. And then often using multiple k-mers to say whether it's a hit or not, as we'll see with Kraken in two more slides. Okay, so often if you see another tool, you know, you could scan the abstracts, be like, oh, is this another k-mer approach? Oh yeah, okay, it is. It's sort of doing maybe something similar, and for whatever reason, it's faster or better. So then the other big question is, this sort of came up earlier, is, you know, what happens when you have a hit? So this could be a k-mer hit. It could be with bow tie or something. What happens when it hits, you know, multiple things with essentially sort of equal confidence? Okay, so for whatever reason, you've basically said, my read hits these two different species, okay? And you've defined whatever that cutoff is to say that's a hit or not. And also you've basically said, well, I can't really rank them either, right? So you're sort of treating them equal here. Say they're both at 98% identity, right? They have the exact same score. What do I do about that? And that could happen. Well, it's going to happen all the time. It could happen because it's LGT, but just because there was, you know, it's a more conserved gene, right? It didn't evolve over time fast enough. So obviously this happens a lot. And the problem with just taking the top hit, so this happens a lot too, is, hey, why don't you just take bow tie, take the top hit, call it your species, man, you get like down to the strain level every single time. Well, that's great, but your top hit could also have multiple other hits down here that are just as equally as good. Yeah, this has been a problem for a long time. There's like papers about why you just can't take the top blast hit for lots of reasons. And so you have to then sort of account for this and say, well, there's uncertainty with this particular marker. And so the most straightforward approach to this is some sort of form of lowest common ancestor, where basically you say, we will take the branch that basically covers our hits, and we will call the identification of that taxa down to that level, but we won't call it any further because we're not sure if it's this one or this one. So in this case, these are species. If it had been these two, we would call it this genus, but because essentially it spans at the family level, this is a taxonomy tree, we're gonna call just to the family level of Enterobacteriaceae. And so lowest common ancestor has been used for a long time with a lot of different tools, and they're often paired with k-mer approaches. Yeah.
So you only accept things with 100 confidence?
No. This is just an example. Like, it depends. So the defining what is a check mark here depends on the tool and how it decides whether it's hit it or not.
Okay. So it's really situation specific as to how low down the taxonomy.
Yeah, because there's lots of different ways to say I have a hit to this organism. And obviously, okay, well, there's a big difference between a hit at 70% versus a hit at 100%. But usually what they're doing is they're defining some stringent cutoff. And then they're saying on top of that, well, obviously I can't rank them, so the hit's almost identical, or they can't differentiate, especially with k-mers, right? Where it's like it's short. Yep. Okay, so a little bit more in depth about Kraken here, just to give you a sort of a real life example, or not a real life example, a mock example. So imagine you have your query sequence, you generate all the k-mers now for your read. The k-mers have already been pre-computed for a database, and you basically identify where these k-mers hit within your taxonomy tree. And so some of them, you know, hit perfectly as a unique thing to a tip. Some of these essentially are further up the tree. And then you say, okay, given this information, what do I call it, right? Because I have multiple k-mers with multiple hits, sort of multiple LCAs. And so Kraken essentially says, I will call it, you know, the furthest point on this leaf node with the most k-mer counts. And this is what it does by default. Now, the fun thing is a little bit is that there's a confidence score within Kraken. This is going to go a little bit more detailed. The default score is cut off at zero. There's like they don't use it. But that means you're going to get a lot of essentially calls at the lowest point in the tree a lot. And essentially, that could be from only a few k-mers. So how is that confidence score calculated? Essentially, if you calculate the fraction of k-mers unique to that node divided by the total number of k-mers in your read, this would give you a confidence score. So the confidence score for this particular assignment would be 0.15. The default I already told you is zero, so it would just assign to this. If you raised it to 0.2, then this wouldn't make the cutoff. What happens next is, okay, what if I raise the cutoff? The other approach is then you can move up in your tree, right? Sort of taking this lowest common ancestor, you add now all the k-mers below that node as well as this node, you get 14. Now 14 essentially of the k-mers of your read equals a confidence value of 0.52 and so on. You could take this node and push her confidence up. So increasing this cutoff sort of raises, it either removes our ability to annotate reads, or it sometimes pushes it up the tree. Kraken is specifically paired often with Bracken. So you can imagine now with that reference database and these k-mers, if you keep adding more reference genomes, right? You sort of are this product of a problematic thing where you actually push reads up the tree more often. Essentially, adding more genomes results in that LCA not getting down to maybe a strain level as much. And so it often pushes a lot of your calls sort of up the tree. And so you lose that taxonomic resolution. Bracken is this Bayesian approach to essentially correct for those estimates and essentially tries to push these calls back down to the appropriate species, looking essentially for multiple reads across your sample to say, oh, it's more likely that because most of our reads, this is oversimplification, comes from this one species, we don't really need to push all these ones up here. We can push it back down to what we think is actually there. Take-home message here is that Bracken recommends combining with Bracken to improve the taxonomy assignment. Okay, so where are we at here? Right, this is interesting. Okay, so the big question, of course, with metagenomic taxonomic assignment tools, which one's best? The classic, which one is best? This is difficult to assess. People have done this. If you search for it, you're gonna find papers where people have assessed different metagenomic classifiers. There has been like sort of widespread movement, not a movement, like a, oh my goodness, what would we call CAMI? Like a critical, so there's this thing called CAMI, which is critical assessment of metagenomic inferences. I don't know. Anyway, basically people have generated a lot of different in silico samples with the hope of being like, this should be our benchmarking test, right? And people will compare their tools with this. And what you'll find is that, you know, everyone's tool is the best, amazingly. Like you go read this paper and they're like, MTU's OTO's 3 just put out their paper and like they beat all the other tools. And then you're like, oh, cool, that's the best one. And then you go over here and then Metaflan 4 published their paper and they're like, oh, they're better. And then Kraken publishes a new paper and then they're better than all these ones. And so, yeah. That's pretty frustrating. But the reality is how we essentially assess which is better is technically difficult. It depends on whether you're using mock communities or synthetic communities or real communities. It depends exactly how you're calculating like F1 and fun things like that. And they're fundamentally different sort of approaches. So of course we had to add to that K chaos of trying to compare different things. We thought because we didn't have a tool in the running here that we would be unbiased and we could just, you know, simplify it a bit and be basically focused on Kraken versus Metaflam. And mostly what started this was a bit of a frustration internally that there was an appreciation that both tools kind of had major limitations. And so this is a weird graph because we're just like, we're covering up a lot of data here and it's really small, I just realized. But essentially what's showing is if we took a human associated samples and we did 16S sequencing, we often found about 117 ASVs. So we're sort of in that range, number of species-ish, right? And then that's great. So then if we did Metaflam with metagenomics, in this particular case, our average was about 64. It's in the same ballpark. It's half. It's in the same ballpark though, okay? And you're kind of thinking, well, maybe it's because it's metagenomic data and we didn't get to the same depth of resolution. So that's why we counted less things. And then over here is Kraken 2 with a very large database. And now we're getting 22,000 different species. And what's the difference here between these two, Robin? I don't remember. Oh, thank you. Yes. Yes. Okay. Right. Thanks. So with the confidence score set to the most stringent of one, we would get this down to about 568. But like as a starting point, this is not even talking about overlap or anything, just counting the number of things. Like these are widely different on the same set of samples, right? It's not that 6S should maybe perfectly match with metagenomics, but like the fundamental question of like, well, how many species are in that sample? Like, oh, it could be 100 or 60 or 500 or 21,000. I mean, like seriously, this is like after years of work on this, right? So we kind of want to address this. And then if you look at environmental samples, this kind of goes even more like wonky. So then you're like, well, at least Metaflam's better, right? You're like, well, Metaflam's closer. So Kraken seems out to lunch. Like, let's just drop that. Let's use Metaflam. And a lot of people use Metaflam for human associated stuff. But then if you go to environmental reads, I believe these are soil samples. So we do 16S on this. So we're in the range of about 426, more things, right? It's soil, more diversity, obviously. And then we ran Metaflam on. This is Metaflam 3. So caveat here, this is not with Metaflam 4. And maybe this has greatly been improved. But like our mean was 0 with like a few down here. Like absolutely falling apart, right? Like, oh, this is the best tool available. Oh, you run on soil samples and you don't detect anything. Like that's awful, right? And then you go to Kraken and Kraken's like, yeah, well, there's 33,000 things. And then like once we at least found this confidence cutoff that we didn't know about for a while, we're like, oh, we can get that down to like 115, which is actually now less than the 16S data. All right. That's sort of a take-home message here a little bit by itself. Like there's this vast difference going on. So we were like, okay, let's try to figure this out a little bit. And like, because classic thing is like we have data, we need to know how to process it. And so we want to know the answer. Okay, so in this study, obviously this is Robin's study. Basically what we did was she had 400 previously simulated metagenome samples. So we know essentially the community composition within these samples. The caveat here is that these are known species. This doesn't really take into account what happens in like when half your species are unknown or something. So it's known species. And then our big thing here was to compare Kraken 2 versus Metaflam with different databases and different cutoffs. I don't want to go into the whole paper, obviously, because that's just a bit much, but I just want to show you some overall trends here. So this is with Kraken 2. And what's happening here is you're looking at the proportion of reads classified by increasing the cutoff. And then these wispy lines are just obviously for every single sample. And then you sort of see what the majority looks like. So essentially, you know, the bonus of using a low confidence cut threshold is that you get higher assignment of taxonomy to most of your reads. And again, these are synthetic communities, so we're hitting almost 100% of our sample. In a real soil sample, that wouldn't be the case. And then this graph essentially shows the dissimilarity in the number of species identified. So literally that counting thing we just did where we know the number of species. So ideally we would be around 0 difference, meaning we're not overestimating or underestimating. And essentially you can alter this confidence value to find sort of where it's closest to that. So in this particular case, it's about 0.5. And then L1 distance is actually asking the composition, not just counting the species, kind of like Bayes diversity here. What is the difference between the known community and then what Kraken's calling it, again, with the different thresholds? And we see that this distance improves slightly here with an increase of the confidence value. And then if it's too stringent, you start to essentially remove some of your data too much and you lose the true composition. You can also calculate essentially mean precision. You can calculate, precision recall and F1 scores. And we did the same thing looking at, you know, where that confidence threshold was. In most of these cases, the take-home message is that the default of zero is probably not a great idea. And then the last thing I want to cover, I know I'm going through this quickly, this is mostly a teaser, is we compared essentially Kraken to, I didn't talk about it, with we had lots of different databases, with Kraken 2 with a very large complete database. And this is Kraken 2 with essentially Metaflan's database, which they call ChocoFlan. So it's kind of like equal footing on the database size. And then this is Metaflan on the bottom. And then these different thresholds are essentially the data that we got from our previous assessments. So some of these are the maximum, the confidence that maximized our F1 score versus L1 distance. But the take-home message is that, you know, at the default confidence threshold with our largest, essentially our F1 score is not great, right? It's pretty low. And Metaflan is down here, so it's beating it out. And even if we look at using the same database, it's around the same. But tomorrow. Tomorrow. The human pipeline uses Metaflan as the first step. Yeah. So if you've heard of human, Metaflan is actually what it's doing for the taxonomic assignment. Is there a question? Sorry. Yeah. Okay. Very good for like well-characterized communities. Definitely, like if you're doing human microbiome, probably mouse studies, no problems at all. You're going to probably get a bit more consistency, very good precision. So what it calls as being there is likely there. Might suffer a little bit from, you know, novel species not detecting it, but does a great job. Kraken 2 and probably other k-mer-based approaches, you can get it good for human if you play around with that confidence threshold. Essentially what you're trying to do is remove all those false positives, right? It has a super long tail. You're getting all these extra things called. The benefit, I guess, from Kraken and null reads approach is that you can change that database a bit, right? So to satisfy whatever organisms you're particularly looking for, you can make it bigger and bigger. Memory size does get crazy. So like the Kraken database that we're using was over a terabyte in size. The default is to try to load that into memory, which requires a lot. There's ways to maybe get around that, but it's computationally very intensive. I think if you are using it, you're definitely going to probably want to play a little bit with the confidence threshold and looking essentially at the how many reads are annotated versus how many species it calls, maybe even trying a couple to sort of see for your sample what it looks like. By leaving it at zero, you're going to get a very overestimate number of species with a lot of essentially, I would say, false positives. Yeah. And usually bigger is better for database size. Okay, I have two more slides. I know we're just a little bit behind, but we'll have a coffee break here in just a second. So what about, question in the back? Yeah. Yeah, so within the Kraken, like if you go to their website, they have sort of their default. They even have a mini Kraken database. We talk a lot more about databases in the paper if you want to see those trade-offs. You don't want to use the mini Kraken database. It's good. I think we actually use it in the tutorial, but just because we don't have the computational requirements to do it properly. But so the nice thing is, yes, it's fairly straightforward to build a new database, right? Download your own genomes, run essentially the database command within Kraken. I mean, it's computationally intensive. It takes a while, but you can make it yourself and then run Kraken on it. And essentially with the defaults, with Robin's paper, all those databases we have made available. So if you want to use the database we constructed and used, you can download it and apply it on your data set. It's going to take a while to download, but yeah, you'll get it. Okay, so what about assembly? So far, I've been only talking about reads, right? Just like raw reads, and we've been talking about short reads. Why not assemble first, which Robin's going to go in more detail about what assembly is, but the idea of collapsing reads into longer fragments, why not do that? And people ask this a lot, right? Because one, in theory, it's kind of nice because it collapses some of that complexity. Instead of millions of reads, you would essentially collapse those reads into contigs. So you reduce the number of reads for the similarity searching. So computationally, it makes sense, right? Also, in theory, you're going to maybe get a longer contig. So now you have a bit more information. You're not restricted to 150 base pairs. Even if you improve it to 500 base pairs on average, now you have a longer read to do that matching. The caveat is, and I don't think people can really get around this argument, is that if you're looking for an unbiased way to say how much of different things are in a community, assembly is going to work better for the more dominant organisms in your sample, right? They're going to collapse to longer fragments, while the rarer things are going to still be your shorter fragments. And that's going to create a bit of a bias in your ability to assign taxonomy to those long reads and not the short ones. And then that will turn into a bit of a bias of the composition of your sample, right? It's basically going to sort of overestimate your more dominant things. Do I have the data to actually back that up? No, I actually haven't run it, but I think it makes sense. And could there be ways to correct for it? Maybe as well. But essentially, if you're trying to just profile the microbiome, I think assembly is maybe not the step you want to do at this stage. Assembly is great for other things. Don't get me wrong, for sure. We're going to talk about MGS later. But from a pure, like trying to get how much of different taxa, maybe not the best. What about long reads? And so this really hasn't come up in the past. Long reads were primarily focused on, the idea of assembling genomes and MGS. Not so much of using them as the primary purpose of assessing taxonomy composition. But as more and more people, do it, as more and more people use Nanopore or PacBio as their main sequencing approach for a sample, they want to know the taxonomy too. And so what are you going to do for that? It's something I actually haven't personally done that much. So this is not much from my personal experience, more just from what I've seen. But overall, we don't have that bias from the assembly. So now we have the benefits of long reads without, that bias of possibly assembly. And so we can think about taxonomy and, maybe we can just apply the same methods. And you sort of can. And this is the best paper I've seen. And I saw it before and then I reread it yesterday to dig into it a bit more. It's detailed. But essentially, if you're interested in this, they compare Nanopore and PacBio sequencing on four different mock communities. And they compare essentially these different tools that you can see on the bottom here. And they break them into essentially some of these, what they would call sort of short read tools. So you see your Kraken and Bracken, they list them separately here. They have centrifuge with two different actual parameter settings. They have Metaflan, MMOTUs, SourMash is also a K-mer approach. Then they get into what they refer to things that are a bit more long read aware. MMSeqs is actually just a protein alignment step. So you actually have to get proteins first. Megan's been around for a long time and they actually have some long read mapping as well. And BugSeq is, I had never heard about this before. I looked it up. It's a commercial company, so you have to pay for it. And so obviously maybe not doing as much for the majority of the data. And then some of the marker-based approaches are falling over a little bit here. And then they also then do this precision recall approach of saying, how well did it actually get the correct answer? Because it's a synthetic community, we know the right answer. But then we see, again, that the recall is good here with crack and bracken. Precision not so hot, likely because, you know, they didn't change the confidence score, which is fine. Like, I didn't develop Kraken, by the way. I know it sounds like I'm a fanboy or something here, but like, basically there's a trade-off there. But then some of these long reach approaches are doing better. Again, I don't have an experience with this to say, you know, which one you should be doing better. But if you do have long reads, I would check out this paper, maybe check out these tools if you're interested in that direction. Yeah, question in the back. The reason I don't know why they separate the two, because you can't run Bracken without Kraken 2 first. And then there's this blog post that the Kraken developers are kind of interesting, but I mean, they basically say, no, don't do Kraken 2 for taxon design. Are you crazy? You have to use Bracken. And it's like, oh, okay, cool. Like, I don't know why they just didn't combine them. But anyway, I think the developers and most people would agree that you should apply Bracken after Kraken. You can just use the Kraken output. And it, like, from this graph, it looks like there's no difference. But I guess in theory, it sounds like you should usually apply Bracken. Okay, any other questions? Wonderful. That was good. That was a slog, but I liked it. Okay, so that is it. After this, we're going to get into the lab.